way as we can. It's all art direction because of the camera that's over there. We'd like to make this look like a big full session. Those who are camera shy, who is clearly all of you, may want to stay where you are. Also, if you are asking questions, please stand up, which is, again, a very camera shy kind of thing. And I do understand a lot of people don't want to be on camera, so I'm going to try and get the Twitter feed up there. So if you don't want to be on camera but do want to ask a question, hashtag it NetHui and hashtag it copyright, and we'll see that, and I'll keep an eye on it and ask questions on your behalf if you don't want to be on screen. You won't be on screen, of course, you will be broadcast live across the internet, which is completely different. My name's Hayden Green, I'm from Consumer New Zealand. I've done a lot of stuff on streaming media recently, so I put my hand up to facilitate this session. We also have Matt here from Global Mode. He's doing a Google search. He's clearly not worried about what his search history was. We're going to be talking. Oh, and also thank you very much for not going to the Sex on the Internet talk. It's great that you're here instead. Yeah, don't suddenly rush out. We're going to be talking today about copyright. We've got three subject matter experts that we're going to have do like a very short précis of the various areas of copyright. And after that, then we'll open it up to Q&A. So it's going to be a little bit different to all the other sessions. So if you have a burning question, you're like, oh, I really want to ask that question, keep it until after they've done their talks, and then we can have like a nice big open discussion. Also, because this is like kind of an area where everyone's going to really want to argue with each other, keep it nice, keep it civil. Don't like, if everyone starts piling in on one particular provider or something, I'm gonna like ask people to rein it back. If you think your cool snarky comment is cool, yeah, keep it to yourself. So that's how we're gonna run this. We'll get that Twitter feed running. But let's start with Patty. Patty Buckley, do you want to start this one off? Oh, you okay? You can. Would you like to?
Sure. Do you want to give some contract? Someone else who's prepared something.
Oh, okay, cool. Paula or Trish? Who are we going to? We'll go with Trish first. Trish from Australia is going to give us a sort of a rundown of like Australia.
No, it's not a rundown of Australia. It's a rundown of the entire world, because we can do the entire world of copyright in 5 minutes, right? Right. Yeah. Excellent. Okay. So, copyright and the internet are one of those really interesting relationships, and you'll often hear a lot of concern from people who make their living from being rights holders, concern about the fact that they have a traditional model that relies on selling off certain packages of things. What the internet does is make it really easy to copy things, really easy to distribute things, and therefore it's really easy for things like piracy to exist, which is a fundamental undermining of the business model. On the other hand, when you look at it from the internet works by relying on being able to copy and being able to distribute. And so when you start trying to restrict how you can copy and how you can transmit data, you have the possibility of breaking the internet, or at least of making it less efficient and more cumbersome. So that's where you get such a huge range of tension between copyright and the internet. But at the same time, some of the best things happen because of copyright and the internet, and we are getting new business models, better distribution, all of that sort of stuff. So I wanted to do a really quick pre-say of where are the big things that are happening around the world at the moment in copyright? And I wrote notes because otherwise I was going to forget all of them. So, what are the big topics at the moment? Well, there are things like website blocking. So, huge issues with piracy, huge issues with websites that make a living or promulgate basically infringing copies of material. And one of the ways that rights holders have been trying to stop this is website blocking. So we've got it operating now in Europe, in Singapore, in Australia. There are definite moves afoot to trying to get it to work in the United States. A whole heap of problems with that for the internet. Apart from the fact that there's a fundamental question about starting to block off certain sections of the internet from certain people, you then run into other issues when you do things like block IP addresses, and you have the the harm of collateral damage when you try to take down one site on an IP address and you take down a whole lot. If you are blocking at DNS level, which are the numbers, as you'd all know, that you use to basically look up to find your websites and resolve your web addresses, you have the problem of starting to undermine that very basic structure of DNS lookup. And so you have huge concerns around things like that. Another way that piracy tends to be attacked is when you start doing things like sending people warning notices, asking ISPs to throw through warning notices, tracking IP addresses. Some of the issues that arise with that are people's fundamental rights of privacy on the internet, and to what extent should the internet be surveilled in order to contain copyright? Should people's actions on the internet be monitored in order to make sure they're not infringing copyright? Or should we be, where's that balance between privacy and law abiding? Then you have things like, what about services like Global Unblock or using VPNs? Is it better to be able to have these techniques to let us visit all the various parts of the internet, even if sometimes people are going to use it to mask their BitTorrenting behavior from kick-ass torrents? So we've got a whole heap of fundamental questions around that. How else do you do it? Do you start putting TPMs on everything, so technological protection measures? Do you start putting DRM on things, digital rights management? Is it better to try and have closed ecosystems on the internet, or should we be striving for a more open internet experience? And then you hear giant cases like the Google and Oracle case in the United States, where the question was, can you copyright an API? And if you can copyright an API, does that mean that you can stop other people using an API, which risks that fundamental ability for interoperability, not just on web pages, but with your mobile phones? And as we're moving into an ecosystem of, say, the Internet of Things, how important is it going to be for people to be able to create interoperability things without explicit permission? Copyright over software is a whole other issue as well. And things like DRM, copyright over software, all of those sort of things are issues that New Zealand is likely to face quite soon, when your copyright is likely to change if you sign up to the TPP, because all of those are currently in there. And then you've got the real big other fight. So in Europe at the moment, we're heading for digital single market. So at what point and how do you regulate a digital single market? And because of the way that these firms are interact, so Google exists in all over the world, the MPAA exists all over the world, if we're going to have a lot of fight over regional territorial licensing in Europe, I can pretty much assure you that we will have fights over regional territorial licensing everywhere in the world. So that's likely to be a really hot topic. What do you do with things like data? Should data be protected by copyright? Do we need an exception to do things like data and text mining? Or should we be working off data sets that we shouldn't give copyright protection to? Should we actually make sure that people can do data and text mining? When we have the ability to aggregate data on a grand scale, what are the constraints that you should be putting around that data? So, basically, at the moment, in the New Zealand context, all of those are the big sort of battlegrounds or interesting philosophical fronts that I can see at the moment, copyright and the internet. And when I say all, they're the biggest ones. There are always some more skirmishes around the side. Those are the sort of things that you guys are likely to be facing. And as I said, the big looming thing in New Zealand is that the TPP, if ratified, will have an IP chapter that means that you will have to change your copyright legislation. Things like you will have to sign up to the WIPO internet treaties. Now, if you do that, you suddenly are going to have a different terminology about those temporary copies and various things. You're going to have to re-examine your caching exceptions, your TPM exceptions. When you are doing that, you have the chance to implement this in a way that is, frankly, much better than my beautiful hometown of Australia. And I wish you all the very best of luck in doing it. Go forth.
Shall I introduce myself? Excellent. That'll save you getting it wrong, won't it? Paula Browning, I'm the chair of We Create, which is the Creative Sector Alliance in New Zealand that some of you may or may not have heard of. I was reminded earlier this week that We Create is celebrating its first birthday this week, so hopefully there's cake at the end of the session. That would be quite nice. But as a creative sector person, you're probably looking at me and thinking I'm going to stand up here and I'm just going to defend. Absolutely not. I don't feel the need to defend copyright at all. I think that the thing I want you to take away from today, which I wrote notes about because I work in publishing, of course I had to print them out, is that copyright is the underpinning of the creative sector business model. And I think the creative sector in New Zealand is an important sector and it's really important for our future. So I'm going to ask you to do one thing while you're listening and participating in today's session, and that's instead of thinking that copyright is broken, if you can, because you can't watch Game of Thrones at 1 p.m. on a Monday afternoon because that's when it's launched in the United States, open your mind just a little bit more and think about what we as New Zealanders want from our creative sector in the future. The internet is a massive opportunity to get New Zealand creative content to markets that have not historically been able to be accessed from the bottom of the South Pacific. But in order to seize that opportunity, we need people to be prepared to invest in the creative sector. And unless there's a business model that lets them do that, there won't be any investment. In the parliamentary forum yesterday, Claire Curran said that she worries what the job market will be like for her 15-year-olds. And I wonder if either of Claire's children are actually creatives. Wouldn't we want them all to be able to earn a living and work in the industry that they have a natural talent for? And if they have that wonderful mix of tech and creative talent, then the games industry is crying out for them. This is the games industry that this year will generate $500 million. In revenue, of which most of is export earnings. And that's what New Zealand's good at. We're innovative, we're creative, and international markets love our music, books, games and movies. So as Amy Adams said yesterday, we don't want the unintended consequences from legislative reform. Let's think about copyright in the fullest sense and how much of a contribution the creative sector can make to the economy in the future, because we all know that cows aren't going to prop us up forever.
Thank you very much, Paula. Paddy, you're ready now. All right, awesome. This is Paddy Buckley from Quick Flicks, and he's got a microphone. Awesome.
Thank you. Right, slightly on the fly here. I actually wasn't aware that I would be called upon, but that's fine. Look, just a few thoughts on content, as I understand it, or as it applies to my business, which is video streaming. So I think of content as online video. Geo-blocking, I feel, it's slightly taking us, I guess it's not the central issue as I see it. The central issue, and Trish, apologies, we were tweeting about this yesterday, but for me the issue is about the current licensing model that we see from I guess mainly from the US, but also we deal with Europe, continental Europe, UK, and wherever we get our content from, it's done territorially, so it's done by territory. We license content for we license New Zealand rights. And I think what happens from there is that, if you like, I have concerns with a view. It'll be a popular view in this room, I think, and mine will be the unpopular one. But the view generally seems to be that, you know, it's fine for me to watch Netflix in the US and I'm paying for it, therefore I'm not pirating. And I do understand that. I have some sympathy with that, or let me say I had some sympathy with that a couple of years ago when I was standing in roughly here and talking to a similar audience. The issue today is that we've come a long way since then. We've now got 4 subscription services. We've got the free-to-air streaming services also offering differentiated content. We've got a lot of other services as well. And I would challenge anyone in this room to name me 5 TV series that you cannot watch, let's say, legitimately through New Zealand services. 2 years ago, that wasn't the case. You could name a lot, but now you can't. And the point is that there are these legitimate New Zealand services that are there, and there's no grey area for me. I think one of the points is that it's only the local services who are going to support the development of the local of the digital creative industry in New Zealand. So we license local content. We've got a couple of people over here, Lightbox, Connor's sort of half representing Lightbox, I suppose, through Spark. They license local content. Chris is there, sort of nearly from Neon. They license local content. Netflix have got a bit of local content, but if we were to look at the alternative and say, right, well, let's move to a model of global rights. I don't need global rights. I don't need the right to stream in Belgium or somewhere else. And the truth is that actually, if we move to a model of global rights, that really serves only one dominant global provider, which is Netflix. We would be forced to pay more, somehow our prices would be affected, and it actually doesn't strike me that it would be in New Zealand's best interest for that to happen. I suppose you can just sort of say that I just would take this position given the business that I run and all the rest of it, but for me, it's important that we do support the local services because there's a clear legitimacy there, but it's also because of the development of the digital industry that we want to see. It's really important that I think that's the case. And I guess the final point that I would make is that if we were to, if we're going to be using services to allow us to access overseas content, the issue, it's really the same point. They push us away from the local content. They push us away from the local services. They push us towards overseas services, and that those overseas services have no interest in New Zealand. And I think that's an important point that's sometimes missed. For me, we have a great interest in New Zealand. We deal with the New Zealand creative industry all the time, and we want to help it and develop it and develop the digital side of it. And that's what we're trying to do. So I guess those are my thoughts on geo-blocking, but really it comes down to the licensing model. The only other point to make is that, like it or not, the guys who put their money in, put their hands in their pocket and fund this content, we're in a golden age of television, everyone keeps telling us, the people who are funding this content, they are the rights owners. You've got to play the game by their rules, like it or not. I mean, they have the right to do what they're doing. Some people might find that model offensive of slicing it up and so on and distributing it country by country, and I have no doubt that model will evolve and change and so on, but nonetheless, you have to respect that they're the ones who funded this content in the first place, and it seems to me that's the way it is for now. Now, it will change, it will evolve, and it will develop, but the combination of respecting the rights owners and supporting the local digital industry are the two main points, and that's where I come from.
Awesome, thank you, Patty. Come this way with the microphone. Come this way. Come on. Cheers. So, all right. Those are some interesting perspectives on copyright and content, and we've seen some very good comments up on the Twitter stream. And so, yeah. So now we're going to open this up for discussion. So you can either Brendan, I'll come straight to you. So you can either ask directly of the people who spoke, or you can just ask questions to the room. Brenda, kick it off.
Okay, to throw down the gauntlet. I loved Quick Flicks. I subscribed for ages. I got 2 seasons into Doctor Who and wanted to watch a few more, and there weren't. So I switched to US Netflix. I believe that the thing I'm watching right now is Voyager, because every episode passes the Bechdel test, and that's so hard to find. It probably is on a local streaming service, but I don't want to buy all 4 of them for the 4 series that my family wants to watch when I could just buy the US one. What was his last challenge? I wanted to reply to it.
The 5 shows one, is that the one you're talking about?
No, but it'll come back to
okay.
me. I'll pass the microphone to someone else now.
Okay.
Thank you, Brenda. So, going back to a statement which I kind of agreed, kind of disagree with regards to the copyright is not broken. And I think it's not broken yet, or it's not irreparable yet. The problem I see with copyright and IP in general as it is today is its initial intent was a limited monopoly over that right. And what we're seeing is the extension of that right rather than bringing it back. It's going in the wrong direction. So it's not irreparable if we can turn the tide and bring it in as to where it should be rather than where it's being extended out and effectively being used as a weapon against the users and the consumers of that content. I think that is the key issue that needs to be addressed with regards to copyright as we know and understand it today.
There's a gentleman just behind you there who's got a thing. Yeah, go.
Second, let's agree that copyright is not broken. Yeah, that's true.
Yes.
Copyright is working very well. If you are a provider of content in an industrialized sense, it enables vertical integration from the production of content right up through its distribution, and that works really, really well for an organization that controls all aspects of that. We spent about 10 years fighting against vertical integration in the internet industry in New Zealand for precisely the same reasons. It stifles innovation and it cuts out those at the very bottom levels. So yeah, it's not broken in that sense, in one very small area. In the wider ecosystem, yes it is.
Okay, we'll come this way for Brenda and then back that way. Is there anyone from the content industry who wants to reply to these, by the way? If they want to stand up and reply, feel free.
I'm on IMDb, so do I count? I've got like 20 movies up there. Hi, I worked on Avatar and Lord of the Rings and shit like that. You've got to respect their rules because it's their content. It depends how arbitrary and bizarre their rules are. The rules are that if you're left-handed, buy it there. If you're right-handed, buy it there. I would say, no, I'm not going to follow that rule. That's ridiculous. And I think regional rules for content distribution are getting more and more ridiculous in today's phase. If North Island buys it here, South Island buys it for 10 times the price. No, not doing that.
There are, globally, the stats say that around 28% of people use VPNs or some type of site country-changing technology or another for some reason. So, you know, we say copyright's not broken, but if one in four consumers are deciding to change their location for some reason, then what's going on there?
Hi, I'm Lucy, and I'll pass over to Rick at the end, and I'm a lawyer, and I guess in terms of copyright not being broken, one of the issues is that the copyright laws differ in different jurisdictions, and this issue becomes a global one. And I guess if I'm looking at your global mode T-shirt, I'm quite aware as a lawyer that there's not much precedent for how we should interpret legislation that hasn't been drafted in light of the environment in which we now find ourselves and can't keep up with that environment. So we've got old drafting of Copyright Act that we're applying to novel situations. And I think at a personal level, I'm a little bit disappointed that various commercial entities sitting behind me managed to settle a claim that might have given us in New Zealand some of that precedent. And one of the things I've been thinking about over the last couple of days is whether, as an internet community, we should almost be taking some sort of declaratory judgment test cases to actually say, Court, can we have some clarity over how we shouldn't be interpreting your laws? Regardless of the commercial disputes, we want to know as consumers, is what we're doing okay? And because I actually think as a consumer perspective, Brenda, you're probably fine, but that point hasn't been judicial clarity of that yet.
I better be careful about this because last time I spoke on copyright at a NetHui, I got into a shitstorm. I'll restrict myself to stuff that I know. The first thing is, copyright originally had nothing to do with content. It had everything to do with the regulation of a technology, and the technology was the printing press. And it arose as a result of a complete collapse of a former regime that could be seen as a sort of prototype copyright. With licensing acts and so on and so forth that took place during the early days of the introduction of the printing press, and then through all sorts of hideous censorship in the days of the Stuarts. So it was all about regulation of technology, and although people say copyright law is technology neutral, it is not. Every time a new technology has come along, copyright law has had to change to deal with the new technology. But every single one of those technologies has been based upon a large producer type of model that then goes from a one-to-many type of distribution system. And now we've faced with a completely different distribution system, which is a many-to-many distribution system, which, hey, listen, relies on copying to work. So all of a sudden you've got a completely different distribution system that poses an entirely different model that challenges copyright law. This is what I call a collision in the digital paradigm. And it's something that's got to be faced, and it isn't being faced very well. Because content owners, and hey, I'm an author as well, so I do like copyright protection, but content owners are going to have to face up to the fact that you're going to have to develop new business models. And because the internet is global, get out of this thinking that you can control distribution. It's got to be global. You set it out in one location, you set it out in all. Now, it's a great marketing thing for HBO to say, you can watch Game of Thrones in New Zealand at the same time that they're watching it in the States. Now, if that isn't a response to the problems of globalization and an answer to the problems of globalization, I don't know what is. The whole issue of geo-distribution may have worked once upon a time. It doesn't work now. The business model has changed completely as a result of the technology, and it should be the technology that copyright law is looking at.
All right. If there wasn't a direct response to that, we've got Rick over there with the microphone.
Yeah, hi. This is not a question. This is actually going to be a question, which is a surprise. And this is not about, I should hasten to say it, this is not about Global Mode, and it is not about any similar service to Global Mode. It's about VPNs generally. Now, and I like the way that Paula's organisation has rebranded itself, We Create. And if a VPN allows us to go and get content from from overseas, surely that's benefiting the ultimate creators of that content, because it allows people to pay a fair price for the content when they want it. How then is using copyright to stifle VPNs and stifle international distribution and enhance geo-blocking, how is that good for the ultimate creators? And how is it good that TPP is going to make that even worse by criminalising the breaking of TPNs? Question for the panellists.
Question for the panellists. So if any of those people who were speaking before want to answer that, or if anyone in the crowd just would love to answer that, or if there are some people who are not allowed to. Oh, we've got a microphone coming your way.
I'm going to answer half of it, not the other half. I'm going to ignore the TPP part. Sorry, Rick. I think the one of the things we'll be doing at We Create that we're still in the process of at the moment is to get people to have a better understanding of the business models around the various creative industries. And it's all very well to say that, you know, you've got this creative product, you put it up online, you make it available everywhere, and then you hope you get enough paid for it for your production costs to start with, but actually that's not how the model works. You've actually got to work out how you can afford to pay for the thing first if you're operating at a commercial level. And I come back to the gentleman's question earlier on about stifling innovation. And actually, doesn't the internet now give every single creator an opportunity that we didn't have in the pre-internet age of being able to distribute their own content in any way you like? I mean, that's why I like Creative Commons. It's entirely up to you. It's your choice. But when you're a commercial content creator, you've got investors, you've got shareholders, you've got other accountabilities, and you have to be able to say, this thing is going to make money. And the traditional rights model of selling into individual territories, that's how we fund the commercial level content creation. And that's the difficulty that the creative industries are challenged with, is, you know, the historic model of funding these things is not the only answer going into the future. But I think the New Zealand creative industries particularly are very focused on future business models around creative content, both the creation of it and the distribution of it.
So I want to respond to both bits of that. So both the content creator bit, and also I'd like to touch on the TPM, TPP thing. So, but on I agree with Paula. Like, the internet has given us more examples, and I think, as somebody once again who is a creator and has published a book, I do worry about the amount of effort that goes into enforcing the current business model rather than really successfully thinking about how do you position yourself going into the future. And especially in a country like New Zealand, which is frankly quite small and traditionally has had trouble breaking into that global marketplace. This is a country that really should be at the forefront of trying to break down regional ghettoing, basically, to get the content out there. And to think into the future as well. Now, I don't know how many of you have got kids. A fair few, I suspect. I don't know how many of your kids watch television, but my kids don't. My kids watch Minecraft walkthrough videos on YouTube. And for anyone who can't see this, half the audience has just nodded. That's where we need to start positioning ourselves. And it really, with a system with very limited resources, I personally think you would be doing a lot better to be putting a lot of those resources into getting New Zealand walkthrough videos or something that is going to be that next generation of stuff rather than worrying so much about people sneaking into US Netflix. TPM things very quickly. The TPM thing is a huge issue. So the deal is that breaking a TPM will become a criminal offence, even if you have a right to access that content. The last draft of the TPP had this fantastic thing in there where they've got a couple of exceptions that will let you break TPM, say if you're a library for preservation purposes, but also criminalises the selling of the technologies that will allow you to break those locks. So I might actually have a right to break the lock, but I can't get the technology to do so. And once again, I will flag, we're setting into stone in these sort of TPM regimes things that are going to affect us in ways we're not thinking of. So it's one thing if you're talking about digital locks on audiovisual content or digital locks on ebooks. What about when that digital lock is on your smoke alarm or when that digital lock is on your oven or that digital lock is in your car? Are we really thinking through the processes and these restrictions as we're moving into an interconnected world?
Yeah, Trish, you're absolutely correct. My children watch nothing but Minecraft videos on YouTube. And Paula, the point about stifling innovation and everyone can be a creator, yes, it's true, but it's really, really hard. The break-even point is like 10,000 subscribers on your YouTube channel for content. That is difficult to achieve. It's in the interests of New Zealand providers to publish as widely as possible. Paul Brisden made this point this morning in one of the sessions. If you're publishing a book from New Zealand, you want that in front of a large as market as you possibly can. Publish everywhere as often as possible. I tweeted a pic at the beginning of this session. I don't know if people saw it, but it was the original business proposition that Walt Disney wrote for Disneyland. And it is the clearest demonstration that I have ever seen of an industrialized mechanism for extracting as much money from every visitor to every part of that empire. Disneyland is the focus for going to place where you've heard the songs and you can join my support group for parents of children who have seen Frozen.
Let it go.
I can't let it go. Songs keep movies in currency when films are not on release. They did this for years. You would see a film come back 20 years after its release, and everyone knew the story. Everyone knew the songs because that kept that in the cultural currency. They sold that whole experience of a creative talent pool that could be leveraged to use TV to offset the costs of producing films, to create a wider audience who hadn't seen the original films, but would go back to theaters again to sell the same content over and over again. That is what our traditional copyright mechanisms enable and needs to be released from the new business models that you want to see, because that vertical integration is not there on that scale. It's too dilute, it's too diverse, and there's not enough money to enable the creatives at that bottom level to earn a living from that.
Just an anecdote. I mean, I don't watch Minecraft videos. I watch TV shows that cost $4 million an episode, and I download them over BitTorrent.
I've got some local research that came out in April. The survey was done by Horizon Research of 1,486 adults in New Zealand. And they said that 92.1% of respondents thought New Zealanders should be able to access offshore streaming service without being restricted by geo-unblocking. It's not clear cut, right? It's not across all options, right? People said no, not if the New Zealand programs are already available through New Zealand streaming services, or yes, but only if that content is not available in New Zealand, or yes, if it's overseas and cheaper, yes, if it enables consumers to see programs and movies sooner, yes, if it's provided that it's legal, and yes, under all circumstances. But I'll come back, 92.1% said they thought they should be able to access overseas streaming service without being restricted by geo-unblocking. And consumers clearly aren't getting what they want.
Yeah, I was just wanting to add something to Rick's question about why is it better to have geographical licensing than letting users directly access foreign content. Now, I suspect Rick has a tricky answer to this one, but my partly thought-through answer would be that it could be better for the rights owner to license in geographical areas, because by giving an exclusive license to a local provider that has a lot of customers, they might get more revenue than having those local customers trickle in via VPNs, maybe. And in the context of the TPP, the government might think we would much prefer the revenue came to a local provider than to the offshore one. So that's why we're going to protect local content.
Actually, so real quickly on that, we had a discussion over breakfast this morning about this topic because, you know, always worried about what you're going to say. And none of us were, like, all of us know that people have done the cost-benefit analysis of these exclusive things. So when they sell the exclusive rights, they know exactly how much money they're going to make versus selling it locally or selling it globally. They know how much money they're going to make. They know how much money it took to make the show. So, yeah, there are obviously, you know, businesses know what they're doing. They're being, tigers are being tigers, so to speak.
I find it quite interesting that we're mainly talking about the about digital things and their geographic limitations on the distribution of digital goods, which is fascinating. But there's also that terrible experience that I have all too routinely when I'm browsing Amazon.com, add cart, get to checkout process. No, you're not allowed this. You live in New Zealand. And there's a whole industry with UShop and other shipping escrow services that have popped up around it. And of course, UShop is owned by New Zealand Post, and I find it interesting that it's a state-owned enterprise, which is kind of allowing people to break that geographic access to material. And it may well be that you may want to import a DVD, as people used to do before streaming. I saw a discussion the other day on Reddit where a big fan of Avalanche City wanted to pay someone in New Zealand to go to the iTunes store, download the new Avalanche City album, I think it was, and then send that to them on Dropbox, because it was available in the New Zealand iTunes store, but it wasn't available in other iTunes stores as well. So there's a potential niche here for Lord's second album, where, I don't know, I just think it's a little bit bigger than just digital, though clearly that affects everyone at NetHui the most.
And that's a very good point that links into the gaming industry, which Paula mentioned before. I also write about games, and iTunes Store in the UK often has games, you know, the top premier A-level games for mobile devices for $10, $20 cheaper than it is in New Zealand, and it's a digital product. It's not like they have to put it on a boat and send it to me. And so this is a very kind of interesting question. Do New Zealand game makers send their games to the UK with a premium? Are they selling, are Pickpock selling their games for, well, they don't sell their games, so it's in-app purchases, but are they, you know, are they like more expensive in the UK than they are in New Zealand? Or is that the death knell for New Zealand creativity if they start bumping up the prices overseas with that regional thing?
Yeah.
So that's a problem across software. For some work that I needed to do, I needed a certain video conferencing software. And because I live in New Zealand, I had to buy it from the New Zealand reseller. It was just under 10 times the price of the US one. And it was two versions old, so all the screen sharing, all these other things didn't work. So it was really embarrassing to say to my US clients, you just keep going with the meeting, the other eight people on this video conference, and I, as a person in New Zealand, cannot see the screen because we're not allowed.
I don't know if Consumer NZ's actually done any surveys on this, but last time they surveyed it in Australia, the price of software in particular was on average about 70%, I think it was, more expensive. And there were some fantastic examples, like to get Adobe Professional Editions, it was actually cheaper to fly to the US and buy it physically and fly back again. And the flow-on effects of that are really difficult because, you know, it's one thing if Game of Thrones costs a bit more. Realistically, most of that's just a consumer need. When you're talking about software with that sort of price differential, you are suddenly undermining a huge economic sector because your businesses face a much higher cost barrier than they are in their international competitors.
Vaughan Baker from MyRepublic, a fibre-focused ISP in New Zealand. I kind of listened to this. I mean, copyright's not my area of expertise by any means, but it looks to me as if it's an industry that is undergoing significant sort of threat and change at the prospect of this thing called the internet. And the internet's great for disrupting traditional business models. You know, you look at Uber, Airbnb. The gentleman down the end there talking about, you know, New Zealand Post with UShop. Well, New Zealand Post got to do that. They've got to look to evolve and have a reason to do anything other than just delivering parcels of people buying stuff over the internet. It's a natural place to be. I suggest that if there's a layer in there between the content owner and the consumer that's not adding value, that's not evolving, that's not shifting with the pace of technological change and delivering what the consumer wants and using internet technologies, they'll be dead in the water.
Hello, Daniel, I work in libraries. A little bit of a spiel about New Zealand Post, hopefully I'll make it relevant to this discussion as well. I used to work for New Zealand Post. Kiwi Bank, they started work on that in 1993. When National were saying that New Zealand Post would never have another bank, they were working on it in secret behind them. The three-day delivery that's just come out, they started working on that in 1994. One of the things, and also with deregulation, you make the difference with Telecom and New Zealand Post. When deregulation came in the letters market, New Zealand Post decided, oh well, we'll just open our network to everybody. Telecom basically used confusion and marketing confusion and monopolistic behaviour. The way it relates to this is that with UShop as well, is that for me it's actually quite hard to buy stuff legitimately. It's actually a lot harder. I torrent a lot of that. It's just so much easier. I've tried to buy stuff legitimately, and one of my most famous, well, one of my examples is that I went to buy a game off Steam. And I thought, I actually had downloaded it on a torrent first and I liked it, and usually if I like something, I'll buy it. So I thought I'd buy this game. I had to use the Steam service to download it, and that was okay because it took three times as long as it did to take for me to actually download it via torrent. It was actually slower to actually download than, you know, to pay for the service. So I finally get my game and I'm like, oh great, I get to play it. I couldn't play it because apparently Steam hadn't bought a license for the game. So I'd actually had waited all this time and I'd paid all my money. And of course I'd paid, I think it was, the equivalent was about $80 US when the US price was about, when I translated the US price into New Zealand dollars, it was about 50. so I got ripped off there as well. So I'm just, so finally after 3.5 days, I get the license and I can play my game. When I BitTorrented it, I actually started it and was playing in 3.5 hours. I would like to get more stuff legitimately, but sometimes it's just hard and you've got the Amazon problems. And it's also not just affecting, it's just not copyright as well, but it's just a problem with even buying hardware, computer hardware. It's you know, I use eShop a bit now because quite a lot of time you go to Amazon, Newegg, nope, sorry, you can't buy that, you're in New Zealand, nope, you can't have it, you can't have this. And I'm just sort of hoping that if something comes out of this, it's for the people who own the content, the rights holders, basically make it simple, make it easier, make it better. There's a reason why people are pirating and why people are using things like VPNs and uShop. It's because people want stuff, and they're going to, and if they really want it, they'll do anything they can to get it. So it's up to people here, maybe be a bit smarter in the long term, and also just to be a bit better about how they can distribute stuff to make it easy, to make it simple.
Jordan here. I just wanted to come back and get you to think of a counterfactual, which is, if there was no copyright of digital goods at all, if copyright didn't exist, would we invent it? And I, by the we, I mean here, I mean citizens. So would we say, do we need copyright as opposed to just asserting the moral rights of authors of copyright works? And I think the answer to that is yes, because the idea is that providing a limited right to control and benefit economically from a copyright work, we encourage the supply of it. So from a social point of view, the reason for copyright's existence in the law is to increase the supply of copyright goods. That's the only reason in a public policy sense it exists. Now, all of the people who make money from existing copyright want to make more money from copyright. They want to make more money from their goods. That's absolutely logical and perfectly fair enough. But policy shouldn't be written by those people because they've got a self-interest, obviously, right? Our collective interest is in maximizing the production of copyright goods, not in maximizing the return for any particular copyright good. So I just think that, that's a contextual factor that we always need to keep in mind, not because people should be able to get material for free, but because the constant lengthening of copyright terms, the constant extension of copyright into places it could never have gone in the real world. So you know how you bought a physical book, you could sell it to someone. Buy an e-book, it's quite hard to sell it to someone. How if you sort of took the wrapping off a CD, you could use it and give it to someone, but now they want to make TPM breaches illegal, even if the copyright, even if the law says you're allowed to access the content. So we've got to look at all of these things, and it's not easy, especially when large dollars are at play. I mean, Spark, as an example, has invested, what, $40 million, Connor, in Lightbox, something like that? How much? $40 million in year one. So there's big bucks on the table, right? And trying to have a debate that's rational when people have got a lot of money on the table is quite tricky. So I guess I'm just urging people to do the counterfactual. If it didn't exist, would we have a problem? Do we have a problem with plunging production of copyright works? Is there a shortage of movies? Is there a shortage of books? Is there a shortage of music? I don't think the answer to that is yes. So one option is we just don't change copyright law. We don't update protections. We don't expand the protection that's provided. And we just let this disruptive internet that Vaughan was talking about do its work and see what happens later. But that also seems to be not a thing that policymakers want. But the final point I make is that there are powerful lobbies on one side of this equation pushing for tighter protection, and the consumer interest, by contrast, is weak and disorganized because none of us lose too much if things get a little bit worse, but some people stand to make a lot of money if things get tightened up.
So we've got just a little over 5 minutes left in the session. So we've got guy over here is going to talk. I'm going to go here. And then if you've got like burning questions, then we come to next. Yeah, to reply to Jordan, is it? Oh, okay, that's a question. All right, so third, and then we'll work our way around. So where you go?
Thank you. Hi, my name's Raj. I just wanted to share a perspective that I've seen from Bollywood movies of a different way. They operate, as you know, copyright in India is a bit of a joke. People just download everything and anything under the sun for various reasons that you're well acquainted with. But what it's forced the industry to do is to get really creative with what they can do and what they can't do. One of the things that I wanted to share is that there are a lot of Bollywood movies legitimately released on YouTube by the copyright holders within a couple of years now of them being released in the movie theaters, and they're looking for other ways to monetize them through YouTube, through advertising and so on and so forth. Just an observation of a system that is more at risk potentially than the one we have here.
So I just want to point something out is that back in the Napster days, people said, no, this piracy is going to kill content. But we've never seen a bigger explosion of media despite the piracy problem. If anything, the piracy is actually driving innovation. It's this threat that is actually driving innovation. And there's a whole sphere of opportunity that we've actually completely missed, and that's actually physical goods. We're seeing stuff like the Thingiverse, where you can basically reproduce physical goods within and share it on a global market. You can get to have people that actually work together on these works, and it gets released into the commons. And with or without piracy, as gentleman has indicated, we don't need strong copyright protections to have these industries flourish. And it actually just flourishes despite of the stronger protections and extension on the copyright that comes in. And people are actually just ignoring this. People are going to go on, and they're going to go on what works for them, regardless of what laws are going to come in the ways that people try and enforce it. As people work away around these problems. And that's what the internet was developed for, is actually to route around censorship.
I'm with Jordan on the issue of putting copyright into the hands of authors. And I'll give you a very brief example. 1985, I wrote a book about Tolkien. It was published by George Allen and Unwin, which was later absorbed by HarperCollins. The book is now out of print. Routledge want to re-release it, and they wrote to me saying, do you want us to print it? I said, fine, let's get in touch with HarperCollins and see if they'll release the copyright, because they're the licensees. Haven't heard a word, and I wrote to them about 6 months ago. It's a pain in the ass, because I got a publisher that wants to publish the book. Hey, I'm going to make a little bit of money out of it, and they just have glommed the whole situation. So let's put the control back in the hands of the authors. The only reason that it's in the hands of big licensing organisations and so on and so forth was because of market failure. You needed to have a one-place, go-to place to get your permissions. Now you've got the internet, you don't need to do that anymore.
Another point that I wanted to throw into this, it's Narelle here in Australia. The concern I've got is that some of the legislative reactions to copyright are somewhat less well-framed than they could be, shall I say. They seem to be somewhat ill-informed when it comes to the technology. And so with all of this talk of the use of VPNs in order to get around copyright, and with so much money on the table, I'm quite concerned that we'll end up in a situation where VPNs are banned. They're demonised so much that VPNs are a useful security measure on the internet. They're a very useful tool. You use them not just to avoid copyright. You use them in order to secure your traffic on the internet. So I don't want to see them banned or demonised any further as a disproportionate reaction to copyright breaches.
I don't, in some ways I'd like to respond to Jordan. I think there's proof that I'm sure people like Judge Harvey be aware of. The Germans did a study and figured out that they got off the ground a hell of a lot faster and have been more successful since by not having patent law, but copyright law put in place as early as the Brits did, and killing themselves off early on in the piece. But I think one of the most salutary things is to look at the WikiLeaks situation, where it's very evident that there was no agreement on what was the purpose or objectives of copyright. And it's equally salutary to look at our Act, look at Australia's Act, look at Britain's Act, look at Canada's Act, and try and figure out what they say their purpose of copyright is. Because I think if you can't agree on that, you can't agree on what you're actually going to do in consequence. And I think this is a really, really big issue. In talking to MB about it, they said that they felt, I queried them, and they said this person probably shouldn't have told me, but they felt that probably the purpose and objectives would be decided at the end of the TPP, once they'd figured out what the rest of the IB chapter was doing. And I think that we need to challenge these things. And I welcome Judge Harvey's comment some time back, where he said we really need to look radically at the Copyright Act. What chance we have with things like Berne Convention in place, I don't really know. But I'd really like to think that the work done, that's been published beautifully by Derek Hardy, I think where he's done an excellent summary of really the return on investment, which shows actually from the economists that he had cited, that most people, the economists felt that it should be, the copyright length of time should be more in the order of 14, 30 years, not unlike the early stages in the UK, and for real value before actually it gives others to take advantage of the social benefit of what's involved in what is copyrighted.
Okay, so we just heard the TUI. It was the happy TUI, though, not the angry TUI yet. So we've got a question here from Brenda, but something I want everyone to think about is, like, what is our call to action at the end of this? What do we, like, want to see? Do we want to, you know, are we storming Parliament demanding they change the copyright law and not sign the TPP? Yeah, actually, yeah, we should. I didn't say that. Don't write that down. Have a really good think about what you would like to see out of this. If you don't want to say it on the microphone, again, tweet it or chuck it in the collaborative notes. But yeah, that's for this last 5 minutes. That's kind of what I'm thinking of, like action pieces, like things we want to do. Sorry, Brenna, I may have like set you up for something that is not that, but here you go.
Okay, I wanted to ask the people who've given this more thought than me on copyright reform. I think you were proposing an end of work for hire, if that's the right term. I'm trying to imagine how that would work when you have copyrighted items that had 5,000 people work on it. It won't work when there's a book and there's an author, but when there's a film, the author's considered the director. I mean, how would that system even work when you've got so many people on a single work?
I was just he's sneaking out.
Sure, incentivize creators. That's the only purpose of copyright. It is to provide an income for creators to encourage them to continue to create. That's it. End of story.
So 5,000 people would own the copyright on a movie? That's what my question was.
Well, yeah, in a sense, because they would all receive the trickle-down from the organisation that created it. I mean, you've got the organisation that creates it, like the company, right? Then the problem starts to get a little bit bigger when you start introducing distributors and all of that type of stuff into the equation. It's the authors and the creators who should be incentivised, and that's where the buck should stop.
Speaking of that group, the distributors, we have distributors here, and I don't want to like single them out. But if they do want to say anything, they will. It's a safe space. We're not going to like pile in on there. But if you would like to mention anything that's been talked about today, no, that's all right. That's cool. I just thought I'd give you the chance. Tweet at me, DM me if you want to say anything. Cool. Got a question over there.
I'm Matthew Holloway. I think there's two things I'd like to see from copyright law reform. One is that pirates do actually offer the best service for content, and that's quite well known. There's no DRM, you just download the content and use it. So what I would actually like to see is I don't actually like the business model of Netflix, of Lightbox and things like this. It should be that you buy an indemnity. So these organisations, the equivalent of when you go to a cafe, that the cafe can actually pay to be able to play music, and they don't need to negotiate because it's via something, an organisation like APRA. There should be an equivalent where you can buy an internet licence to be able to download as much content as you want, and then that is of course distributed back to the authors. So to essentially get rid of the distributors, because the distributors are getting in the way and adding DRM and making a lot of problems there. Second thing is reducing the length of copyright. There is sort of a, people talk about, you know, reducing it down to 15 years. Another way that's perhaps between that versus, you know, the lifetime plus 75 years is to have, say, 15 years, but you can opt in if you want more protection, because that deals with the whole orphan orphan works problem, because orphan works are when something is covered by copyright but you can't get legal access to that anymore, and that's just an ongoing problem with the US trying to push for everything. So Mickey Mouse, you know, never falls out of copyright, they just keep increasing it. So, but that's the 1% versus the 99% of stuff that could be really, really useful to society and to economic gain and cultural gain. And so that 1% are dragging down the 99% with copyright extremism. So we need to reduce the length of copyright, but perhaps just have an opt-in for Disney, because maybe they'll accept that and they won't lobby as hard against that kind of idea.
No one, oh, well, look at that, Tui. That just saved us from embarrassing silence. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you for your contributions today. We've obviously got the collaborative document online, and we've got this lovely wall of post-it notes that Matt's been putting up. So thank you all very much, and thank you to our speakers, and thank you for coming. Thank you.